Thank you for joining us again this Wednesday. We are continuing our study from the book of Ecclesiastes, which the word Ecclesiastes simply means the preacher. Today we're going to be finishing chapter 4, which I'll read a few verses here in just a moment. Before we do, I want to remind all of you of the 4th of July A day parade coming this Saturday. The parade begins at 9 o'clock, and our float will be in the parade. And if you want to be on the float and you want to be singing some of the songs of God Bless America and so on like that, you're welcome to come and get on the float with us. You'll have to be on the float by 8:30 because we're pulling out to go down to the link to get in line to get in the parade. Also, if you do not want to ride on the float, the parade route runs right in front of the church there on the Vance side of the parking lot. You can sit there and watch the entire parade come by the church. Also, this year, we've done this every year, but this year we have ordered 600 of these fans. And they're the head of the hit parade, I'll tell you that right now. But we're going to use them as a seed card. There's 600 of them, approximately. And it just got the name of the church and information that way. But on the back side, it's got a part of a scripture, Proverbs 14:34, where it says, "Righteousness exalteth a nation." And that's all we're handing out. But we really have a wonderful time doing that, and people really enjoy getting these fans. And it's just kind of become a tradition, and I hope you'll come and join in with us. Today, in Ecclesiastes Chapter 4, Solomon begins our study today. We'll read beginning in verse 5, and he makes his second observation. The observation is the difference between two extremes. The extremes are the lazy man versus the man who would be considered a workaholic. So I'm going to begin reading in verse 5, and he starts by making the observation of the lazy man versus the workaholic. Chapter 4, Ecclesiastes, beginning in verse 5. "The fool foldeth his hands together and eateth his own flesh. Better is an handful with quietness than both hands full with travail and vexation of spirit. Then I returned, and I saw vanity under the sun. There is one alone, and there is not a second. Yea, he hath neither child nor brother, yet is there no end of all his labor. Neither is his eye satisfied with riches. Neither saith he, For whom do I labor, and bereave my soul of good? This is also vanity. Yea, it is a sore travail. Two are better than one, because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, the one will lift up his fellow, but woe to him that is alone when he falleth, for he hath not another to help him up. Again, if two lie together, then they have heat, but how can one be warm alone? And if one prevail against him, two shall withstand him, and a threefold cord is not quickly broken. Better is a poor and wise child than an old and foolish king, who will no more be admonished. For out of prison he cometh to reign, whereas also he that is born in his kingdom becometh poor. I considered all the living which walk under the sun, with the second child that shall stand up in his stead. There is no end of all the people, even of all that have been before them. They also that come after shall not rejoice in him. Surely this also is vanity and vexation of spirit. And Solomon begins there in the reading of chapter 4, giving us some observations. And this begins, the part we read today, begins the second admonition, or the second observation, excuse me. And the observation is the lazy man versus the workaholic. He says the lazy man sleeps away his hour of opportunity. He refuses to work because there might be a lion in the street. He's like the hinge on a door that just turns. He turns back and forth on his bed and never gets anything done. He refuses to get up because he knows he's going to have to face some of his troubles. And so he just lays in bed and eventually goes hungry. He goes hungry most of the time. He ends up hurting himself as well as those who are counting on him or her. He says, what's the use in going to work? If I work, I'll miss all the fun. Or he has this attitude, why shut the door? Somebody's going to come along behind me and open it again. And here's one. He says, why take a bath? I'll just need to take a bath again tomorrow. He will never realize that his own laziness is causing much of his hurt. He also wants to blame everybody else for his lack of success. His laziness will rob him and those people who are counting on him. The lazy man wants and cannot have. Or if he does manage to get something, he can't hold on to it very long. And he always has excuses for his lack of success. And he will never be able to figure it out. The results will be devastating just because of his laziness. His laziness will rob him like a man that is armed. He'll take what he could have had. Secondly, he observes the workaholic and wonders why he spends all his time working and never takes time to enjoy the fruit of his labor. Solomon is observing two extremes. What he's teaching is this, that we must learn that there is a balance between the two. Sleep and rest are necessary for a well-balanced life. Work is also necessary to be able to enjoy your life. And Solomon even teaches us that it is a good thing to enjoy the fruit of your labor. And with that being said, I can remember in my youth that it was almost like it was a sin to actually enjoy your life, to go and do things that we take for granted these days. But back when I was young, there was a lot of things, a lot of, they call them standards, that kept you from, I think, enjoying your life. It is not a sin to spend your money and your time enjoying your family and your friends. In fact, I would say it's wrong not to spend time with your family. Just as it would be wrong not to work to provide for them if you're able to work. We must find a balance between rest, work, and play. I think all three of these are necessary for a well-balanced life. The next observation that Solomon observes is the man who lives alone. He didn't say a whole lot about him, but he wonders why he works together riches and lands and all kinds of things, but he has no one to enjoy them with. And certainly he has no one to leave it to. And Solomon seems to think that having a family and having friends are an important part of a well-balanced life. What's the use in gathering if there's no one to leave it to? And what's the use in gathering if there's no one to enjoy it with? In the Proverbs, Solomon makes this observation. He says, a wise man will leave an inheritance to his children and to his children's children. And he will leave it to good causes. You cannot take it with you. But like Jesus said, lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. And I think that's what God wants us to do. To use our wealth and use our strength and gifts and talents to the glory and honor of our Lord, Jesus Christ. And in so doing, I think we're laying up treasures in heaven. Helping and doing for others is very important. Otherwise, Solomon seems to be saying gathering things and having things really has no lasting value. Then the next observation he makes is that of relationships. He teaches the importance of cooperating with family, with friends, and those people who are closest to you. Cooperating, meaning that sometimes you're not going to agree on every single thing, but you're able to cooperate with people who have different opinions than you. I've learned this truth. If you don't bend, you will eventually break. Life is not designed for isolation. Friendships and fellowship and getting along with your fellow man is essential to a well-balanced life. Those people who don't get along with others usually end up bitter, lonely, constantly fighting depression and anger. God intended for us to be a social people. I want to repeat that statement. God intended for us to be a social people. That's one of the things that I have against this treatment of this COVID-19 is the isolation factor. I think it's wrong. People need people. We love people. We need to see people. We need to touch people. We need to see the smiles of our children and the smiles of friends. And I'm just in disagreement with that isolation thing concerning this COVID-19. If you want a good relationship, you must learn to be friendly. Solomon said, that if a man is to have a friend, he must first show himself to be a friend or to be friendly. You must learn kindness, tolerance, forgiveness, and mercy. If you don't, your life, as well as those closest to you, will be miserable. I cannot stress strongly enough that the most important relationship is a right relationship with God. That is simply the most important relationship you can have. It begins by having faith in God through Jesus Christ our Lord, putting your faith and trust in Him. That's where the relationship with God begins. A Christian, you as a Christian, you will never be happy apart from having a right relationship with God. We are here on earth to help and to serve one another. You actually rob yourself of blessings when you're selfish and refuse to help others, to isolate yourself from the needs of others. It will help you. It'll help you to get your mind off of yourself. When we work together, we can and we will accomplish much more. It's where he talked about two are better than one. The last observation he makes in chapter 4 is the search that people have, or the desire that people have, for notoriety or popularity. He tells us that it is better to be poor and to have good character than to be a foolish king or a foolish president. He says, people want you to be successful when you're young, and people will try to help you be successful. But there comes a time when parents and friends want you to stand on your own two feet. They love you. But as you grow older, people get a little tired of helping you get out of all the messes that you got yourself into. Eventually, you got to learn to take care of yourself, taking care of your responsibilities. Solomon warns us that everything we have in this life is temporary. Things and people, even position, can change very quickly. Only our relationship to God will last throughout eternity. Jesus is our rock and our foundation. And if you really want to build a successful life, build it on and around Jesus and the things of God. For God never changes. In fact, Jesus, who is the Son of God and God the Son, is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And His love for you will last not only in this lifetime, throughout your life, but in the life to come. Next week, we're going to look into chapter 5, and the things that he observes there is he teaches us to respect God, teaches us to respect God's house, and to respect those people who are leaders in your community and in the Lord's house. God bless you until we see you next week.